type.
Do you have Goshen slaves?
It is live.
Great, thank you. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our special meeting for the City of Capitola. Let's go ahead and begin with our clerk, Chloe, who has a few words.
Thank you, Mayor Brooks. Hello and welcome to the special City Council meeting this evening. In accordance with the California Governor's Executive Order N2920, this meeting is not physically open to the public. Council and staff are meeting via Zoom, and there are several ways for the public to watch and participate. Information on how to join the meeting using Zoom or a landline mobile phone, along with how to submit public comment during the meeting tonight, is available on our website, cityofcapitola.org, and on the published meeting agenda. The public can also live stream the meeting on the city's website. As always, this meeting is cablecast live on Charter Communications Cable TV Channel 8 and is being recorded to be rebroadcast on the following Wednesday at 8 a.m. and on Saturday following the first rebroadcast at 1 p.m. on Charter Channel 71 and Comcast Channel 25. Our technician this evening is Kingston Rivera. Thank you, Kingston, and thank you, Mayor Brooks.
So, and we'll just go ahead and move on to item one for roll call, please.
Yes, Council Member Bertrand.
I'm here.
Council Member Kaiser.
Here.
Council Member Peterson.
Here.
Vice Mayor Story.
Here.
Mayor Brooks.
Here. Welcome, Council Members. So nice to see all of you. If you can please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America
and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible,
with liberty and justice for all. Thank you very much. Now moving to item two, additional materials. Do we have any this evening?
Mayor Brooks, we did not receive any additional materials for this meeting.
Thank you. And moving on to item three, additions and deletions to the agenda.
No changes.
Okay. Next, we're going to be moving on to item four for public comment. So we'll now open public comment for this item. If you'd like to make a comment on about something not on this evening's agenda, send an email now to publiccomment@ci.capitola.ca.us. Or to speak, please raise your hand now by clicking on reactions. Then clicking raise, or then this will raise your hand, or you can dial *9 on your landline phone. Our moderator will unmute you. You will have 3 minutes to speak. So we'll start with the audience. Is anyone's hand is raised?
Mayor Brooks, I do not see anybody asking to speak on public comment. And I do not see any emails on this item.
Okay, we'll just give it one more minute for anyone interested in submitting a public comment via email. And then we'll move on in just a moment. As I get a bit more organized, I'll use this time. Okay. Larry, anything new?
I do not see anyone asking to speak on this item.
Great. Okay, so we're going to move on to item five. This is City Council or staff comments. We'll begin with staff.
I don't believe we have any comments this evening.
Okay. Any comments from council? Vice Mayor Story.
Thank you, Mayor. I just wanted to report out that for our next budget session, which is May the 20th, I had volunteered to represent Capitola at a Santa Cruz housing event, which starts at about the same time that our budget session starts. So I just wanted to report that I probably will not be able to attend the next special budget session on May the 20th. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Vice Mayor Story. Any other comments from council this evening? Council Member Bertrand.
Yeah, I understand there was a meeting with the residents of Depot Hill and the artists for the stair project. Is there any report that can be brought out on that? I heard from Mary Beth Cahalan that a lot of questions were answered, and possibly since the riser is being painted, that in a sense makes it much more safe. So I was just wondering if there's any report back from staff on that, if anyone attended it from staff. Thank you.
I do see a hand from Vice Mayor Story. I just want to see if this is, if Vice Mayor Story wanted to respond or if staff would rather. Or did you just put your hand down, Vice Mayor?
I did.
Oh, he's not in. Sorry. Okay, so it looks like, Larry, you turned your camera on. Did you want to add?
Yes, Mayor Brooks, the artist held a kind of a question and answer session with anyone that was interested in the project. We've received an email from some folks down the villas that said he couldn't attend, but we also received three participants from, I believe they're all from the Depot Hill area, had some questions and answered, and Mr. Kirby, the artist, answered them. There was no definitive thing, but it was more of just an open question and answer session. It lasted about 35 minutes. So that's all I have to report.
If item will be... Was there any response from the BIA? I've heard they're very enthusiastic. Did they send in any emails or participate in that meeting in any way?
I received an email from the BIA, but they said they were, the person who sent it was not allowed, wasn't able to participate. I did inform them that the project would be discussed at the May 27th City Council meeting.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other council comments? Seeing none, we're going to move to item 6 for consent calendar. Do I have a motion to approve consent? Councilmember Peterson.
To approve consent.
Councilmember Peterson.
I will second that.
Great. We have a first from Councilmember Bertrand and a second. May I have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Bertrand.
Aye.
Councilmember Peterson.
Aye.
Councilmember Kaiser, out of order, sorry, everyone.
Aye.
Thank you. Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
Mayor Brooks.
Aye. Okay, that item passes unanimously, so we're now going to move on to item 7. This is our general government. Item A, which is presentation of the proposed 2021-2022 fiscal year budget for the City of Capitola's general fund and the Capitola successor agency. I'll now turn this over to staff.
Thank you, Mayor. Before our finance director, Jim Albert, kicks this off, I just wanted to do a little bit of an introduction here. The first is this is obviously an important time of year when we adopt our budget, which is really the city's blueprint for its operations for the next calendar year, fiscal year, excuse me. This is the first in a series of four scheduled budget hearings. Usually the latter budget hearings are occasionally canceled if council's questions and answers and we can reach consensus on the budget before then. We do have another budget hearing coming up on May 20th, as Vice Mayor Story alluded to during his comments. So you don't need to make any final direction tonight. There are a couple issue areas that we're going to highlight, and if the council is ready to give feedback on them, we're happy to receive it, but we can also continue the conversation out to May 20th. The other really important thing to do tonight is, if there's specific questions or issue areas that you'd like staff to dive into more deeply at a future budget hearing, we're always happy to hear that. We're always happy to provide that information. So as you listen tonight, don't feel pressure. You don't have to get it done tonight. And if there's specific issue areas that you'd like us to focus on for the future, that can be helpful to call those out. And with that, I'll turn it over to Finance Director Malberg. I also do want to congratulate him on the great work preparing the budget. It's always a huge lift to put that in place. And he's been working really diligently with all the department heads to help prepare the budget for this year. So with that, Jim.
Thank you, Jamie. Good evening, Mayor Brooks and City Council, and happy Cinco de Mayo. Let me take a moment to share my screen. Can you all say that okay? Okay, I'm going to start with just kind of a summary of where we, how we got to where we are right now, getting through this last year with the pandemic going on, and then just kind of go through some high-level stuff before I turn it over to the city manager to kind of get into those key discussion points that he was mentioning during his comments. So as far as from a summary, our local economy is starting to show signs of recovery from the pandemic, and we're realizing that the fiscal impacts that we originally anticipated were not quite as severe, were not nearly as severe as we thought. We had originally anticipated about a $4 million revenue shortfall from our prior estimates for fiscal year 2021, which resulted in about a $4.5 million budget gap that we were trying to close a year ago at this time. Our revenue reductions, actuals for last year in comparing to fiscal year 18-19, were down $1.1 million. And if you recall, that's just the first 3.5 months of the pandemic when the shelter-in-place orders were first issued. So that was what we were seeing at this time last year, is kind of how we developed some of that $4 million revenue shortfall. As you're all well aware, the restrictions began to lift right after the 4th of July holiday, which also coincides with the beginning of our fiscal year. So we're estimating that revenues will only be down about $1.3 million rather than the $4 million that we had originally thought. On the expenditure side, again, comparing to fiscal year 18-19, our expenditures actually increased in 19-20 by $1 million, but they were, however, $633,000 below budget. So a lot of our expenditures had already taken place when the shelter-in-place order was issued, but we were able to come in at $633,000 below by really tightening the belt that last quarter of last fiscal year. Our estimated decrease in expenditures for fiscal year 2021 is just under $2 million. That's an estimated number, but we feel pretty comfortable with that number at this point. Our proposed general fund budget is structurally balanced, and I've made some changes from the FAC meeting last night that we'll get into in a little bit, showing that. The estimated fund balance for June 30th of 2022, also the same as 2021, is about $1.4 million. In addition, we have $600,000 set aside in the general fund as a COVID stabilization account. So there is the potential, as we go through this hearing and future hearings, to utilize some of the fund balance for one-time uses. Our ongoing purse costs remain our major threat to city resources. Right now, we're estimating that our PERS contingency reserve is going to be at about $987,000 June 30th of this year. However, our unfunded actuarial liability from CalPERS is sitting at about $26 million. We're hoping that doesn't grow this year, since the when they did that, the economy was still kind of in rebound mode. So they should have captured all of this kind of growth in this year. So we're hoping that number doesn't change a whole lot, or if anything goes down. But we'll find out around August, September timeline. Again, we have a heavy reliance on both sales and transit occupancy tax. And there is some anticipated changes to online sales tax revenue distributions that may have a negative impact to our sales tax revenue. So staff will be watching that closely and report back to council as we get some clarity on what those changes, if there are changes, it sounds like there will be, but what those changes are going to be and what the impacts will be. As far as our reserves, both our contingency and our emergency reserve remain at target balances, with contingency slightly over $2 million and our emergency reserve at a little bit under $1.5 million. This is a graph just showing how we've built the reserves up. So as you remember, we went through the Great Recession and the housing market crash in the early 2000s, followed by the storm pipe failure in Lower Pack Cove. And at that point, our revenues were utilized down to the point of about $500,000. At this point, we've built them up to just under $4 million and anticipate to get a little over $4.5 million over these next 2 years. So this is a summary with major categories, both revenues and expenditures, showing that the budget is balanced, with revenues exceeding expenditures by a little over $4,500, leaving $1.97 million of fund balance, but again, there is $600,000 of that designated as the COVID stabilization account, leaving a budgetary fund balance of about $1.4 million. As far as a revenue summary, these are our major revenue categories, and you can see in the proposed column that revenues are returning a little bit better in most categories than our pre-COVID revenues from fiscal year 18-19. Taxes are up a little bit, license and permits are down, and intergovernmental revenues. Charges for services are coming back, which is a really good sign. Fines and forfeitures pretty flat, and then the other two categories kind of move around there. Sometimes grants come in the middle of the year that can impact those, but as of right now, that's where those are sitting. As far as our revenue forecast, we get our property tax estimate directly from the county assessor's office, and we're anticipating almost $110,000 of growth in that in property tax revenue. Our Bradley Byrne sales tax, we're anticipating a little over $392,000, and that estimate is coming from our sales tax consultant, HCL, which was kind of interesting as we did our own estimates in-house with staff and then met with HCL, and we were almost identical with their estimates, so it makes us feel a little bit better when everybody's kind of seeing the same thing and projecting the same thing. As far as our district taxes, measures F and O are each going to, we're anticipating grow about $60,000 for a total of $120,000 in total for those. TOT, we're expecting growth of $450,000, and that will match, that will be really close to what we actually received in fiscal year 18-19, so that's a good sign that the vacation rental market and industry is recovering and doing well. Our cannabis tax, we're expecting $162,500 of additional revenue on top of this year. This revenue started out really slow when the first shop opened and has slowly been building up over time. But these last 4 months have been really encouraging, and these revenues are kind of working back towards our original projections before we issued those licenses. So that's a good sign there. Parking and parking citations, expecting to grow a little over $225,000 and $50,000 respectively. Those are back to kind of our historic averages. And my one note on the parking revenues is we're saying historic average, but we've backed out about $30,000 of revenue to account for the outdoor dining through the end of August. So that outdoor dining in the village has been taken into consideration in that parking revenue forecast. As far as revenue notes, our general fund revenues, we're expecting to increase $1.4 million from last year, which is about $84,000, or in the grand scheme of things, relatively equal to our fiscal year 18-19 actual numbers. Our sales tax and TOT together represent about 57% of our general fund revenues. Our top 25 sales tax generators represent 70%. And the part that makes us nervous is our top five generators represent 41% of that total. So we're very dependent on a limited number of businesses from the sales tax front. On the kind of a more promising comment would be, or optimistic comment, our March 2021 TOT revenues were actually equal to our March 2019 TOT revenues, actually a couple hundred dollars higher. So again, that short-term rental vacation rental market looks to be coming back back to pre-COVID levels. Property tax, we didn't anticipate any negative impacts last year, and there were not. Properties continued to go up in value, good or bad, depending on your perspective, I guess. But we have no negative impacts, and that revenue source continues to grow. And then again, the cannabis retail business tax has been increasing over the last 4 months and is looking promising that it's working its way towards our original projections from a few years ago. So graphically, I mean, this is a graph of our sales tax showing Bradley Byrne's Measure F and Measures F and Measure O. And as you can see, they're kind of returning back to that 18-19 pre-COVID level. I think the districts are a little bit lower, but the Bradley Byrne's is pretty close. And then continuing to grow a little bit into next year. Property tax, this one's been pretty consistent over the last 4 or 5 years with about 4% growth annually, and we see that trend continuing. On transit occupancy tax, this is the general fund portion. So I believe we were at about $1,580,000 pre-COVID, and that's what our estimate is this year. and all signs from the last few months, that's a realistic revenue expectation as that market has rebounded pretty well. For the restricted TOT portion, which goes to local business groups, and another portion to the early childhood and youth programming, same type of a graph where it's basically showing that it's returning back to the fiscal year 18-19 levels. On the expenditure side, our major categories here, you can see are relatively flat with the exception of personnel, and that's just kind of inflation and the way that works. When I have another chart coming up later that shows what percentage of our budget goes to personnel costs, it's easily our largest cost that we have, and that's the one that is really growing in this forecast. So let's see, contract services are relatively flat, a little bit lower than pre-COVID. The others, training's up a little bit. We have new staff, we've had some retirements and new staff, new police officers, so we have a little bit more in training budget this year. Supplies is still a little bit below pre-COVID level, but there's plenty of budget there to get through the year. On the grants and subsidies, $125,000. There's also our typical amount is somewhere in the $225,000 to $250,000 as we develop the restricted TOT for the local business groups and youth programming, early childhood education programming. There's an additional, I want to say it's right around $100,000 that we anticipate being able to fund into the community grant program out of our community development block grant, the stuff that community development department's been working on. There's three rounds of that. We expect some of the funding to come in relatively soon. And then some of that money can go in, I believe a lot of that money is going to go into our community grant program. So although that looks low here, the program itself, as far as proposed in the budget, is remaining pretty much intact with how it was prior to the pandemic. Internal service funds, again, we didn't really fund those last year. The majority of last year was our insurance premiums and a little bit into the IT fund as employees transitioned during the shelter-in-place order into working remotely. We're returning those, so we have equipment going back in there, and then compensated absences that I'll get into a little bit later. And then our other financing uses is really just the CIP funding coming back into the budget. We didn't fund any new projects last year outside of our restricted road revenue projects. Personnel, again, growing almost $792,000, and that is growth, which still includes 7.25 positions that remain frozen at this point. The contract services, training, the memberships, and supplies are all kind of growing a little bit. Some pre-pandemic levels, training, memberships a little bit higher. Again, community, the grants and subsidies I talked about, as well as the internal service funds and the other financing uses. So the compensated absences, some of that growth there, if you recall, we put a moratorium on the mandatory and voluntary cash outs of accrued time. We're anticipating that that moratorium will be lifted in the next fiscal year. So we've put a little bit more than we normally would put into that fund to kind of account for those cash outs as people have gone over the maximums and will be cashed out next May. CIPs I talked about. So again, those 7.25 frozen positions represent a savings of about a little over $600,000. The big increase, another big increase in personnel is from the CalPERS UAL. It was growing closer to $200,000 a year. Last year it grew $280,000. We're hoping that number is much smaller this year, or maybe zero would be nice, but we'll see how that plays out. As far as non-personnel expenditures, those are returning close to pre-pandemic levels, and we're putting some things back in, such as sidewalk cleaning in the village, Hope Services, and the temporary seasonal staff that we use in Public Works to help keep the village clean and nice and neat for our visitors in the summer. And then we're returning a portion of the art and cultural event budget. I believe it's about half a season, as we anticipate some of those things being able to happen later on in this calendar year, kind of the beginning of the fiscal year. I have that backwards, I'm sorry. Later in the fiscal year, early in next calendar year, but we'll see how that goes. That could go earlier, hopefully. One note I want to draw your attention to is the Community Action Board has historically received a little under $1,500 from the city's community grant program. This funding has precluded Councilmember Story from being able to participate in decisions regarding allocation of community grants. Yes.
If I'm going to jump in, I'm sorry.
No worries.
I think we might want to give Councilmember Story the opportunity to recuse from this slide so that the council can so he doesn't have to participate in this piece of the decision making tonight.
I left already.
Oh, okay. Sorry, Jim. Please carry on.
No, I was going to do that at the end, but that's fine. At a recent council meeting, Mayor Brooks suggested that funding for CAD could be moved out of the community grant program, which would allow Vice Mayor Story to participate in those conversations about allocating the community grant. So our draft budget does include $1,500 for CAB, but it is now in the city council department. And staff is recommending that council weigh in on this change right now while Council Member Story has recused himself. I will pause right there.
Okay, so just for clarification, you just want to receive kind of consensus on whether we agree to move the funding to the city council department. Is that what I'm hearing?
That is correct.
Okay, and do we need it in a motion, or do we need it just as consensus this evening?
Council consensus is fine on this matter. It's just that because Mayor Story has this conflict, if you guys have already given us feedback, we don't need to bring it up again, and it'll be included in the final council budget. But as long as we get the direction here, well, Councilmember Story is recused.
Okay, I see. Councilmember Peterson, hand raised.
Thank you. I just want to confirm if I'm trying to determine if there's any implications for moving that funding to the city council department. Does this preclude them from applying next year or in other years for additional funding or for to increase that funding? I know with the community grant program, people could apply every year and ask for different amounts. So does this mean they won't be allowed to do that anymore?
So Councilmember Peterson, frankly, it doesn't preclude them technically from applying. This would offset the historical amount that we've given them through the community grant program. Mm-hmm. Because we open up our community grant program and anyone can apply, technically they could still apply. We would make it clear to them what the intent of the city is. I think the disadvantage ostensibly could be that, in theory, if they're participating in the community grant program, CAB could ask for more, and this would then just be sort of giving them a line item. And then in addition, the advantage for CAB is that they're no longer potentially competing with other nonprofits as they do get a carve out in the budget. By way of example, this is similar to how the city historically treated the Begonia Festival, where there was a Begonia Festival $5,000 contract line item amount in the council's budget when we did that festival, and it wasn't through the overall community grant program.
Okay, so am I correct in understanding then that if CAB at any point wanted to request an increase in that, it wouldn't necessarily be through the community grants application program. They would just need to come to the council and ask for an increase.
Correct.
Okay, cool. I'm good with that. Thank you.
Councilmember Bertrand.
Yeah, I'm good with it too. I brought this up before. I thought it was particularly unfair to Sam not to have his voice in the decision-making process on community grants because it's a CAB. And, you know, I think we do want to fund them. That's not the issue. To me, the issue was not allowing Sam to have a voice in the discussion. So I'm definitely for this. I brought it up multiple times before, so I'm definitely with it.
Okay, I've heard from two council members. Councilmember Kaiser?
I'm all for it. Thanks.
Okay. So it seems like everyone's in consensus here with some nod shakes. Okay, I think you have what you need, Jim.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. And then do we want to let the Vice Mayor know he can rejoin us?
Welcome back, Vice Mayor Story.
Thank you. It's good to be back.
This chart right here is showing what our staffing levels historically have been, actual staffing levels. And then what I'm just kind of drawing attention to here is that we still have 67 3/4 positions authorized by the city council. However, this budget is only budgeting for 60.5 of those positions. So that's where our 7 1/4 vacancies are coming as you kind of scroll through that chart there. As far as our expenditure summary, again, our personnel costs are 68.5%, by far our largest, and then contract services, the second largest. The others kind of fill in the gaps. Both of these have, we have limited ability to make reductions there, which is why I like to draw attention to this, just so you know where the money's going.
And I see Councilmember Bertrand's hand raised. I just want to make a point. We're going to treat this like a regular action item and take questions at the end, Councilmember Bertrand. But I do recognize your hand at this moment. We'll circle back with you in just a minute. Okay, Jim.
Okay, thank you. As far as expenditures by department, you can see police and public works are our largest departments, which is why they have the most staffing, which is why they have the largest shares of the expenditure budget. So this is our multi-year projection, and this is where, for the mayor and vice mayor, this is different from what you saw last night. What we did today, was last night you saw deficit, basically deficit spending going out into the future. So today what we're presenting is a balanced budget using Measure F, a portion of Measure F into the operations. And so on that, you have the percentages of what our projections are in the different revenue categories. And so the Measure F to operations represents the amount of Measure F money that would remain in the general fund for ongoing operations. And then the Measure F balance is what's available to be programmed into CIT or whatever the council's desire is with that funding. And then that shows the net impact on the fund balance that the budget is balanced out for this year as well as the five-year forecast. Okay, I have another slide that does that too. Yeah, so there's the net impact is right there. As far as budget principles, we have kind of three overarching principles: fiscal policy, public service, and public improvements. These remain unchanged from prior years. As far as fiscal policy, it's maintain a balanced budget that ensures ongoing operations can be met with ongoing revenues, use of one-time revenues for one-time expenditures, ensure the budget plans for future cost increases and attainable revenue estimates. On public service, it's maintain and improve upon the transparency of city operations and accessibility to government, recognize the high priority the community places on public safety, analyze future service level increases with their long-term financial impacts to ensure financial stability. Public improvements, maintain the city's infrastructure by providing maximum funding for the pavement management system, maintain and improve Capitola's natural resources and sustainable green programs, and ensure maintenance and cleanliness of city facilities, sidewalks, and streets. So, and this is also a change from last night for the mayor and vice mayor. I had these listed as bullet points, which was really busy last night and kind of hard to see. But as far as our key projects and programs, we have these broken into some categories. So I'll start with fiscal is transition from COVID-19 response back to normal operations, but continuing to monitor the impacts from COVID-19 quickly. And these are, just as a reminder, these are the key projects and programs that the City Council identified at our February 25th meeting. So this is where we are kind of organized into this format here. Explore grant opportunities for public safety, CIT, and environmental and outreach programs. Create a three-year fiscal plan for mall redevelopment impacts in-house. We actually kind of have that in place. We're just waiting for the mall project to kick off again, and then we'll update that. But we do have a fiscal plan for mall redevelopment, pretty far along. As far as land use, support creation and expansion of hotels in appropriate locations. Review village hotel parking permits and village parking program. Review parklets in the village, which is the outdoor dining. And this is both, for right now, as far as related to our COVID-19 response, we've got it programmed in through the end of August, but this is talking about whether we continue this program and what that would look like going forward following Labor Day or at whatever point. And then staff to develop a list of projects associated with mall redevelopment and prioritize affordable housing and building community relationships. Our next category is public works. Evaluate traffic flow at Cliff and Wharf and a possible roundabout. sidewalks on Kennedy and McGregor, Rispin Park project, the Claire's Complete Street project, seek a grant with school district regarding soccer fields, picnic tables at Monterey Park, and make available free feminine hygiene projects for all public restrooms. That one's already well underway and actually could potentially be done before the end of this fiscal year, but if not, it's going to remain on there as a key project for next fiscal year. For administration, go above and beyond keeping residents informed, ensure all members made aware of projects that affect them, implicit bias training, and we'll have, I believe we'll be back with some proposals at a relatively soon council meeting. Administrative policy updates, develop a community grant strategic plan.
Before we get off that slide, Jim, I just do want to interject about the administrative policy updates. You know, we have quite an ambitious workload plan for this next year, and so you know that's one that I think has a potential for taking up a lot of city council and staff time. I think we had 99 policies at our last count, and each one, not each one of them, but a significant number of them would require council hearings for amendments. So it's still on there, but I just want everyone to be aware that, you know, the way the workload has gone over the last 3 months, I'm just not sure whether we're going to be able to totally get to that one. So I just want everyone to make sure that their expectations aren't over. We don't miss up people's expectations on that. Or if council says this is a number one thing, we talk about something else that we would potentially not focus on in the near term.
As far as public safety, is expand emergency response planning and pursue grants for a city hall generator. And for recreation, established plan for children's fund, considering parks and recreation strategic plan and needs for scholarships, and also to work with the school district to allow alcohol at the community center, or that's related to special events. And at this point, I'm going to turn it over to City Manager Goldstein as we kind of focus in a little bit and get some of the areas where we're looking for council feedback.
All right. Thank you, Jim. So the key areas we're going to be looking for feedback are five areas. We're going to talk about the frozen vacant positions and what we would like to try to do around that. The ECYP funding, general fund balance that Jim alluded to, the $1.4 million in general fund balance that we have. The $600,000 the council set aside for the COVID stabilization account from last year. And then our federal stimulus funding and then Measure F. Consider putting that towards the WHARF project. So the first discussion point that I wanted to dive into is there's currently 7.25 positions in the city that are frozen and vacant. That's a budget savings of about $600,000. So you can imagine what that would do to our budget if we had all those positions filled at this time. We don't think that we can fill all those positions without a major structural reorganization of our budget. And so in the near term, my suggestion is the following, is that, number one, I'd like to take a look at this again in January, February of this coming year. There's a lot of talk about a potential real vertical recovery in the economy. I'll be honest, my city manager career, I've never seen that before, but I know it's happened in the past. So it would be a welcome change, but you know, I certainly in my career have never seen a situation where you have 7% year over year city general fund growth. But I know that in the 80s, it happens to cities. So for the time being, we didn't budget with that assumption, but I would like to sort of see what the recovery looks like and reevaluate in January, February. In the near term, we're trying to evaluate opportunities to fill some of these gaps that have been created and sort of the biggest service issues that we're seeing in the city with a limited investment of city resources. And we're suggesting $100,000. I think potentially we could get it done for a little bit less. And it would be to fill kind of three key gaps in the cities that these frozen positions create. Number one is in finance. Finance is down a position. We're also down, so we only have one person that does payroll. Doing payroll is a very, very important function for a city. Obviously, if you can't pay your employees, it's difficult to keep employees. So we would like a limited allocation of budget so that we can bump some hours for an existing employee and get them cross-trained in doing payroll, as well as assisting in other functions within the finance department. Number two is The building department has historically always been two people, and we are now down to 1.5 people, partially due to this the shared service model, which has been going well with the city of Scotts Valley. But the idea was that we would have an administrative support dedicated to building, and that hasn't happened, which results in our inspector having to do a lot of administrative work, and therefore the lead time for the permits and the public's experience has definitely been affected. And then the last is in the police department, they lost their administrative analyst position, and they don't have some of the administrative support for doing budget analysis, grant work, and some other functions as well. So what we're asking for is a limited allocation, $100,000, and to try to put that towards filling some of these holes. One of the thoughts we've had is we could allocate maybe 2 years worth of, well, 2 years worth of funding from the fund balance for this effort, and then we would consider it maybe a pilot program, and then we would have to reevaluate when the 2 year cycle was up. So that was the first sort of key discussion point. The next one is about the ECYP funding. That's the early childhood and youth funding that comes out of a carve out of the TOT. It's restricted revenue, restricted by the voters. It can't go to anything else. We estimate that we're going to get about $49,000 this next year. And in the budget, we also believe we're going to have about $14,000 of fund balance that is carryover from this last year because hotel taxes have been stronger than we were initially anticipating. So the draft budget allocates $30,000 for community grants out of the ECYP. So that would be grants to nonprofits that provide services primarily to youth. And that leaves $19,000 of new revenue plus $14,000 of ECYP fund balance. And our proposal to use that would be $15,000 towards scholarships for our various youth programs. We're also suggesting $15,000 for youth enrichment. And really what that is really transportation. Because transportation, which we don't have mechanism by which to move kids around, lets us do more things away from our facility where we're putting something on. So for example, field trips to a museum, things like that become able to do. Obviously, $15,000 does not buy a passenger van, so this would be a bit of an amortized cost that we would, you know, buy a passenger van, and this would be a portion of the cost that we would spread out over multiple years, or we could look at some sort of shorter term lease option as well. And then $3,000 towards staff training for our staff that are primarily working with kids. Next one is the fund balance. As Jim mentioned earlier, we have $1.4 million in estimated fund balance. Historically, the city, this is the difference between how much money we spent in prior years and how much we've received. We've usually tried to keep that number around $500,000. When it gets higher, we would usually come to the council as we're doing here and, you know, look at how to best allocate it. Given the uncertainty with COVID and the pandemic and recovery, we're thinking that maybe a $750,000 target is more reasonable at this point. In general, we would usually recommend a split between, you know, using the fund balance for different types of things, some kind of long-term investments like debt reduction or investing in the PERS trust that is sort of trying to reduce a long-term liability, and then some near-term things like, you know, some of the council goals or some of the CIP projects that we wanted to get done. So the FAC supported at their meeting last night, they supported the funding target that staff proposed. And then they're going to be talking a little bit more about the split if council is on board with allocating around $650,000 of fund balance, how best to split that between projects and debt reduction at their next meeting. The COVID stabilization account, council will recall that was $600,000 we set aside this last year. We had suggested considering reducing that down by 50% and using $300,000 now and then evaluating the remainder of the balance at the mid-year budget review this winter. The FAC suggested delaying that and holding off until the mid-year to look at the COVID stabilization account. And then the last discussion point we have is that we anticipate receiving between $1.8 and $1.9 million in stimulus funding from the federal government. The reason why we don't have a firm figure is we suspect that the state may take a cut out of it. If they don't take a cut, it's $1.88 million. If they do take a cut, it obviously would be reduced. We also have $960,000 of new Measure F revenue coming in this year, and staff is recommending putting those towards the Wharf Resiliency Project. When we have a little bit more information about that project here coming up in the next slide, and the FAC supported allocating both of those funding sources towards the Wharf. So, get to that in the next slide after this one. We'll talk a little bit more about the Wharf in a second. So this just puts these ideas down on kind of one chart, and you can see the American Rescue Plan funding as recommended by the staff and the FAC going towards the Wharf, as well as the Measure F revenue, and then $600,000 of fund balance going towards, at this point, just saying it's a bucket for CIP, debt reduction, council goals, and we can get feedback on that, and then get the FAC's input at their next meeting. And then I did want to remind people that that isn't the only money for CIP projects. We also have about $600,000 of restricted road funding that we'll be talking about next meeting when we're talking about the CIP projects. And then now, I stole my own thunder here, we have the Wharf slide. And the Wharf slide, the only reason I'm putting it up here is I think it helps to understand the context. So the previous cost estimates you've seen suggested it was between a $5 and a $7.5 million project. We've put in about $1.2 million of previous Measure F funding. We spent about $325,000, so that leaves just about $900,000 available. We got this funding from the state of $1.9 million. The American Rescue Plan of just under $1.9 million, also if you allocate to the project, plus the $960,000 of Measure F, would bring our funding total to about $6 million, which gets us in the ballpark to be able to bid this project this fall, potentially. I'm not sure that we're going to be able to bid the project this fall, but otherwise we'd have to be talking about some sort of debt financing instrument to get us to the balances that we need so that we wouldn't have to, so we could actually fund construction. So with that, bring it back to kind of the sort of overall, the questions for tonight, and then the feedback we're looking for is, number one is identify budget questions, and we'll do our best to answer tonight. Otherwise, we can come back with more information at the next meeting. And then there's those five topic areas where any feedback the council wants to offer at this stage would be welcome, or they can be continued out to the May 20th. And with that, staff is available for questions.
Okay, so Council Member Bertrand, you've been waiting. Time for questions. I'll turn it over to you.
Yeah, I just have a simple question for Jim, and I think our main discussion should be the recommendations that Jimmy wants some guidance on, so I'll be brief. The council that deals with city planning issues be considered staff also? They're on stipends, just like city council. So I'm just wondering about that. They're part of PERS, they get a stipend. So you sort of briefly mentioned staff, and I didn't see anything about our city planning group. I mean, our city planning council, excuse me.
Are you referring to the planning commission?
Yeah, sorry.
Okay. So I can take a crack at that.
Okay.
The technical answer is that the planning commissions are not actually employees. But I understand exactly what you're talking about, Council Member Bertrand, in that they do receive a stipend and they can enroll, and they are enrolled in PERS. But the legal answer is that they're not technically employees.
Okay, but only employees would get PERS, I thought, so.
Yeah, the council had, we were now, elected officials are out of PERS, but before the rule was that elected officials and the Planning Commission, it was sort of a separate plan off to the side. So I'm not 100% clear on that. That's something we could answer more fully at a different meeting. I've had this discussion with the city attorney in the past, and she's pretty adamant in her position that the planning commissioners are not employees.
Okay. The city council's in PERS.
City council, existing council members are, new council members, I believe, are no longer. Is that correct, Mr. Laurent or Wahlberg?
That is correct.
Okay, so I'm in PERS, but the new one, sorry, that's weird. Okay.
And that was a change that the council made, I think, maybe a year ago? year and a half ago.
Hmm. Okay. Thank you.
Vice Mayor Story.
Yes, thank you, Mayor. Jimmy, I guess I wanted to start and ask you about the last presentation about the wharf, and you said going out to bid with about $5.7 million. I don't know, yeah, $5.94. I wasn't, could you clarify? You're saying we would, with $5.94, we would go out to bid on the wharf project? I'm looking up there that the project costs are somewhere between $5 million and $7.5 million.
So there's a couple things to think about. Number one is the wharf project is a bit of a, I don't know what the right analogy is, a bit of a tinker toy project, if that's a good analogy. There's a lot of different components to it, and they are, they don't all have to happen. You know, so we had an original project design that we liked at one point, and I think the engineers came back and said it was $20 million. And so we said, well, we can't afford that, and we scaled it back. And so the $5 to $7 million kind of represents the estimated project range. But there's like, you may remember that right now the design has restrooms at the both ends of the wharf. Mm-hmm. So that's potentially, if we ended up with a project that was more than we felt we could afford, that's something we could look at. There's a number of different components that could like either pulled out or added in. In addition, when Jim showed the multi-year fiscal position, there's Measure F coming in for 5 more years down the road. So potentially what we could do, if we decided we wanted to target a $7 million project hypothetically this fall, we could look at how we would get another $1 million of Measure F money in sooner rather than later, whether we internally financed it, whether we went and talked right to a local bank, those kinds of options.
Well, for our next planning session, I was wondering, could you, you and Jim maybe bring back, if we were to kind of aggregate the difference in the Measure F, how much that would make available for the wharf project? And just so that we can see how that's going to play out with the Measure F funding.
We can do that.
Okay, thank you. And if I had one other question, and this is going back to your additional staffing request, which is about $100,000. And also, I mean, just to emphasize that the FAC last night recommended that the council prioritize that request. So, I certainly want to look at ways that we can maybe accommodate it and, you know, stay true to our fiscal policies. The plan here, just using fund balance to kind of fund personnel hours, that seems a little precarious and against our policy of using ongoing expenditures for or ongoing revenue for ongoing expenditures. But what I wanted to maybe throw out there for consideration. And I know this is a bit of presentation, but sometimes that makes all the difference in the world, is if we could use the fund balance for certain general fund expenditures going to the inner fund accounts, such as the equipment reserve, there's like 270 that we're transferring into the equipment reserve account. And whether we could, and since that equipment is a one-time expenditure, whether we could utilize the fund balance for that, that frees up general fund ongoing revenue that could be applied to personnel. And that was just an example. I don't know if there are maybe other examples of inter-fund transfers that we could use the fund balance for, which would free up future revenues for ongoing personnel expenses. And to me, you know, it's just the difference of maybe making those additional hours that seems so precarious after 2 years. You know, maybe the transfer of the equipment reserve becomes precarious. So I wanted to maybe also put that request out there to maybe consider that and look at that for the next time that we come back. And I think those are my comments and questions at this point. Thank you.
Councilmember Bertrand, you had another question?
Yeah, I have another question, Mayor. Thank you very much. Jamie, I wrote some notes down and I didn't capture enough to remind me of what you were talking about. $100K over 2 years, what was that about? Does that ring a bell?
Yeah, so this is this point that Vice Mayor Story is talking about, and it's this, the issue here is that we have these key positions that are frozen, and we have certain staffing impacts and needs that are definitely affecting the public and affecting sort of the city's overall kind of resiliency. So I was suggesting that if we had about $100,000 a year, the staff could develop a staffing plan to sort of strategically plug a few of these holes. And I was suggesting that could take an allocation of fund balance, which would fund this for a couple of years. I think Vice Mayor Story's suggestion is a good one. And we can definitely look at other, you know, to some degree, it's maybe semantics, but I also understand we have our fund balance policies that we need to be very cognizant of and look at other ways to get this done to achieve the same goal.
Okay. Yeah, I wrote that down. I thought it was very good. Some of the positions that needed filling, I think, were critical, especially in the police department, for instance, and they need some analytics. I'd like to understand a little bit more what spending money in those areas would be and how it would benefit our particular departments. So thanks for bringing that up. The other one is I'd like to see more from the FACT talking about putting more money in the PERS reserve. And, you know, I'd like to better understand that if they could address that and give us some more guidance. I guess the transportation issue for the children's programs, I'm a little hesitant to have us get into transportation because of the liability issues. So I'd like to understand a little bit more about how that would be developed for us. So those are some of the concerns your comments brought to my mind. Thank you.
So Councilmember Bertrand, I know that our police chief and community development director are both on the call and they're both prepared, as well as our finance director, but both all prepared to talk a little bit about the service impacts and kind of their thoughts about the staffing. Is that information that would be helpful now?
Yeah, I agree. I definitely want to have a better understanding of what these proposals are. They seem reasonable, but I want a little bit more understanding. Thank you.
Sure. So what I will tell you is that at this point, we don't really have a proposal. If I can get the budget allocation, then we can figure out exactly strategically how we get it done. But I know that our finance director, community development director, and police chief are all prepared to talk about kind of what the hole that needs to be filled is. So, Jim, if you want to kick it off.
Sure. Thank you, Jamie. So, in the finance department, pre-COVID, I had two full-time and one three-quarter-time positions. At the onset of the pandemic, one of the full-time employees resigned and left basically over a third of our hours, our staff hours were gone. Our senior accountant has been able to do, and that position also did the payroll as well as accounts payable. Our senior accountant has been able to handle the payroll as well as accounts payable during this time. We also had a retirement in September, so we have new staff that came on board and replaced the retiree as our account clerk, who is, she started at the end of December. She's now doing very well, and we'd like to get her trained to do backup in payroll as well as accounts payable. I've been nervous. In the last 14 months, I've been one positive COVID test away from not being able to get payroll out, which has made me very nervous. Also, not to whine too much, but our senior accountant is getting prepared to move for the second time during this pandemic and also got married. And I don't think he's taken more than a day and a half off consecutively since the pandemic hit, because we just don't have any backup for all of the things that he does. So my thought was to our account clerk, who started in December as a 30-hour-a-week employee, has moved that position to 40 hours to create that redundancy and backup. That's what I was looking for. I think that cost is probably in the $20,000 range.
I think that seems very reasonable.
Does that answer your question, Councilmember Bertrand?
Yes, it does, Mayor. Thank you.
Okay. Councilmember Kaiser.
Thank you. So this is the way I'm looking at it, and Jamie, maybe you can re-explain it to me. So that savings amount of the $603,000, that is something that we've technically banked over cutting certain positions and over COVID, or is that what could potentially be saved within the next fiscal year?
What this is at the onset of COVID, we had a number of vacancies, right. And then we had a couple people resign, and then we've subsequently had a couple people retire. And so we froze those positions and we didn't fill them. So the savings we've been accruing for the last 12 months approximately.
Okay.
Next, so the 603 that you see there on the screen, that's the savings by keeping those positions vacant next year, how much we would gain. Is what that is. So in other words, if you just said, hey, Jamie, go ahead, hire all 6.25 positions, our budget would now go upside down by $600,000.
Right. Okay. Well, I just want to say, I think that looking at this as a smaller amount, like that $100,000 cap or whatever, would be super beneficial to our city staff, and I know what it's like to be overworked during a time of uncertainty, and just remind, like, that Jim doesn't have backup for payroll. That's super important to our city and our staff and everything. I want to advocate for that. So however the algorithm works, I think it would be super important to people that we already have on staff, but train them, whether it's a few more hours per week that they're adding on these extra responsibilities in order to sort of keep us moving through our, like, kind of reopening and business phase of COVID, and the building permits and things like that. I think that's going to be important as people start to flood more money into the town and things like that. So I would definitely like to see, I don't know if we need more clarification for the rest of council or anything to see where exactly that money is going to go, but I definitely want to push in that direction of allocating not the whole 600, but a portion of that to get our staff more up to speed and more supported and less of, like, that struggle, you know. I think that was my main point going through this, so thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? Councilmember Peterson.
Can you just go back? I thought there was a slide that had a FAC recommendation on it. Am I mistaken?
So we ended up actually building the FAC recommendation to each one of the discussion points.
Oh, okay. That's okay.
So here, yeah. So you and I actually talked before the meeting about potentially using the COVID fund for this idea of kind of setting aside a chunk and saying, hey, this is good for 2 years worth of funding for this. Mm-hmm. After the fact, last night, reviewed it and said, hold on to the COVID fund. We switched over to fund balance to try to make that work, but that would certainly be an option as well.
Okay, I mean, I guess for the sake of discussion and based on what the FAC recommended, I mean, I do think we should be using some funding for this $200,000 for up to 2 years, whether it's from the COVID fund or from the fund balance. If the FAC isn't recommending we use the COVID fund, that's fine. I'm okay with using the fund balance. I think the COVID fund is more of a one-time revenues, so to speak, more than the fund balances. So, I mean, I definitely think that $200,000 would be important to at least cover those 2 years, and then, like it says, reevaluate at that time. Yeah, that's my thought on that item. Sorry, I thought I had seen a slide that had like an overall FAC recommendation. So my apologies.
We did have. Do you want to jump to the table, Jim? So this was kind of the putting it all on paper in one place. It shows, you know, the stimulus funding going to the wharf, Measure F going to the wharf, using the 650, getting more feedback, the 650 of fund balance, and that's the difference between the 1.4 million in fund balance and then holding 750 aside, and then getting more feedback from the FAC about balancing that between projects and debt reduction in the long term. I think this encapsulates, the other piece of the FAC recommendation, and I think Vice Mayor Story may have said it better than I'm going to say it, was I think they also said that there should be a priority on plugging those service needs in the city, so a priority to find that funding for the staffing needs. And please correct me, someone who's on the FAC, if I got that wrong.
I think that's what Vice Mayor Story said. That was the FAC recommendation. I'm going to just jump in here to kind of go over the several pots of money, as this is how I kind of see it. So I'm going to start with the fund balance of 1.4 million. This is a carryover we have from last year to this year, 1.4 million. And what I'm hearing you say is that you would, so this is what I'm thinking, that 200,000 from the 1.4 will go to salaries, right? Is that correct? And then the rest will go to other things and the 750,000. So whatever's left, 1.4 minus 200K minus 750, whatever's left over is what's going to go into CIP projects and other council priorities. Is that correct?
That sounds right to me.
Okay. So what I would say, what I'd like to see to come back in terms of that is whatever that leftover is after the 200K and the 750 set aside, whatever's left. I'd like to see what the CIP projects are at cost so we can determine which ones we would like to finish first, if that makes sense. So if you can bring back those CIP projects and their costs. Then moving on to the 600,000 for the COVID stabilization, I would agree with the FAC committee. I'm on it, so I'm going to agree with them to maintain it, the 600K till whatever they said, the mid-year, to reevaluate where we are at the city level. The ARP. Well, let me actually start with the ECYP thing. So with that, I heard you make a recommendation of where to move some of those dollars. After looking at the community grant applicants for that would actually fall into the early childhood youth program, I'm anticipating that there will be some newer applicants applying for the funding. So I think what I'd like to look at is possibly moving that 3,000. So I think it's 33,000 that's left over there. If we can move 3 of that 1,000 into the community grant, so that bumps it up, is what I would like to see, because I'm anticipating more community grant applicants in this area. We would need more money to cover. And I think the rest to Parks and Rec would be great. What I would like staff to come back on this one is that there's some mention of the transportation, and we have $1.8 million coming in from the ARP funding. And we talk about, this is what Vice Mayor often talks about, is one-time funding for one-time things. And, you know, when this came out, the American Recovery funding, they talked about supporting youth programming and having cities use some of those dollars if needed to support community programming. so, I think. So perhaps staff could look at maybe utilizing some of that 1.8 to like $50,000 of it to actually look into purchasing a van for the Parks and Rec Department, and using the 1.8 of the ARP money instead of pulling it out little bit by little bit directly from the Early Childhood Youth Program Fund. I don't know if it's a possibility, so staff to come back with if that's even something we can use it for, or if I totally made that all up and you can't use it, then that would, you know, make the conversation different at that time. And then for I have no questions about the wharf funding. I think that's fine to bring it to use the rest for the rest of the wharf. I think what I have for now, that's all of the funding options, all the pots of money, correct? That I went over, yes. And then I heard you're going to come back about the road fund at the
we'll be coming back to talk about the road fund and then all those CIP projects you mentioned with the cost estimates, what level of funding we have as you're thinking about allocating the road funds and then the remaining fund balance at our next meeting.
And can you just make sure that we keep it separated, right? So the $600,000 for road funds and the whatever's left, you know, just so when we're looking at it and we're trying to have those conversations, because it's not one pot of money. I think the road funds is dedicated, so that we could just see them separately and how we could allocate the dollars in that way. So that's what I'd like to do to come back. Okay, Councilmember Bertrand.
Yeah, I know we're going to talk about CIP later, but I remember in the earlier presentation, a mention of doing a roundabout at Cliff and Wharf. What's happened with the proposed roundabout Capitola Road and Bay? Is that still not under consideration, or is that so far in the future that we don't even want to consider it now?
So that actually will be a conversation you'll have at the next meeting. I believe that the undergrounding project, we could hear from our public works director, but I believe the undergrounding project that was the predicate to being able to do our roundabout project, I think it's happening shortly. So we would be at a stage where we could start talking about moving that project forward. It'll just come down to council's priorities for where we want to put our money next year.
Yeah, I had my ear bent at Grady's. Someone was talking about how we need a roundabout. He was talking about all the accidents and all the issues at that particular intersection. And I agree, it's been a problem for so many years. So just want to make sure it wasn't being dropped. And I do know that PG&E is gradually getting more money for that undergrounding. So it's nice to hear we're close.
Thank you, Councilmember Tran. Councilmember Peterson?
Yeah, I just want to make sure I'm understanding and I'm not missing something. The slide here says the FACS recommended strategy is to have $300,000 in the COVID reserve.
Oh, I'm sorry. That is a Goldstein version of a line out. I was trying to cross it off.
Oh, okay.
Okay. It probably doesn't make much sense. Yeah, what happened was we developed the slide. The FACS went a different direction. I felt like it was worth saying, hey, staff had suggested this, the FACS is going a slightly different direction. I don't think there's a big philosophical disagreement with the FACS or anything, but I was just trying to show us kind of getting on the same page.
Okay, I thought it was just a spacing issue that something was supposed to be above and something, okay, my apologies.
No, that was supposed to be crossed off.
Okay. Okay, thank you. I just wanted to make sure I wasn't confused between the recommendation. I do want to make, you know, a comment, and I think it's up to the council's, you know, overall as a group, our discretion. But, you know, my understanding with the COVID reserve was that we have it for COVID-related issues, clearly, and that staffing was something that we had to deal with in the last year because of the impacts of COVID. So I don't necessarily think that it's a terrible idea to use the COVID reserve to replace some of our staffing funds. So I just want to put that out there for discussion and consideration, because I understand that it's, you know, mid-year we might find some other things that we also need to spend these funds on, but I do think that staffing was something that we had to cut back on due to COVID, and so I don't think it would be inappropriate for us to use the COVID reserve to replace that. So I just want to put that on the table for discussion amongst the council.
Thank you, Councilmember. So I'm going to take a pause here and let us brew a little bit and think a little bit more about our and go to public comment at this time. Let me find my language. Okay, so now I'm going to open this up to public comment for this item. If you'd like to make a comment, send an email now to publiccomment@ci.capitola.ca.us. Or to speak, please raise your hand now by clicking on reactions, then clicking raise hand in your Zoom application, or by dialing *9 on your landline. Our moderator will unmute you then. You will have up to 3 minutes to speak. Do we have any participants or attendees with their hand raised?
Mayor Brooks, I do not see any attendees asking to speak, and I do not see any emails on this item.
Okay, so we'll just give it a second, and just to let council know, we'll just be bringing this back just for further discussion and questions. As Mr. Goldstein said, no decisions have to be made this evening. Okay. We'll give it.
I do not see anyone with their hands raised at this time.
Okay, and any emails?
And no emails on this item.
Okay. So I'm just going to bring this back to council. I just want to make sure everyone was heard with any other additional questions. Vice Mayor, sorry, I can't recall. Did you have an opportunity for any questions or feedback?
I did.
Okay.
Yeah, earlier. Yeah, thanks.
Okay. Council Member Bertrand?
In terms of transportation, we're going to have special people that deal with kids, I think. Wouldn't that be an issue, Jamie? It's not just buying a van.
So, I think our recreation supervisor is on this call. And if Nikki wants to jump in right now, she has experience in supervising programs that move kids around. And I think rather than me taking a stab at it, because I don't have experience in this field, she might be able to share some details.
That elevates the issue of liability, you know, with the kids. And I know I've had friends that have been drivers for kids in vans and buses, and they have to have special training. So that's my concern.
Thank you, City Manager. I'm happy to answer that question. Good evening, Mayor, Council members. Please let me know if I start to slow down as I'm competing with Netflix in the next room. So as far as having vehicles for youth programming, I think one of the things that you might be remembering is that when a vehicle is of a certain passenger or length, it becomes a bus. And I agree that we would want to avoid the purchase or rental of any vehicle that would put us in a bus category, because it does require a specific bus license, and that is very burdensome for to maintain hourly staff members who are the individuals that would work with the youth in after-school programming or camp programming and have them appropriately trained as with a bus license. Now, you can buy the vans that fit with, that do not classify as a bus, and that would be where I would recommend we go. Because then it is your basic driver's license, and then the city would do its own in-house training to ensure that a staff member is familiar with the vehicle, familiar with the size, familiar with what it is like backing up that particular vehicle, and actually do some checklist in those skills to ensure that they will be safe. Any staff member that we hire on in our hourly positions, they're already getting a DMV check upon hire. So a lot of the necessary checks that we would have for having staff driving youth, that a lot of that already exists. So really, to me, the key is just making sure that we don't get into a situation where we're considered driving a bus.
Thank you, Nikki.
One question.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. is there special liability insurance that we'd have to take out? Seems to me kids are a little bit special and we have to deal with them in that regard.
Well, in the past, we have transported kids. We have usually done this by chartering a bus. And buses now are very, very expensive. To drive a group of students from the community center to Simpkins, round trip is about $1,000. So it's a prohibitive expense to provide enrichment to youth. And so that is the only other real option that we would have. I do think that I've had, you know, having these conversations in regards to the liability, we can definitely double check on that. I don't have the answer at the tip of my fingers right at the moment, but it is something that many recreation agencies in our county are regularly doing. So I feel like it is something that we could achieve.
And I can share that it is a covered, we are covered for that. We are not covered if we want to operate municipal buses. I know that that's excluded from our coverage, but youth transportation is covered.
Okay. Any other questions? All right. So seeing that there's no further questions, I believe council has, staff has received some feedback from council this evening and has what they need. Does staff need any clarification on the request from council this evening?
Let's just summarize, I think, what I heard. The biggest thing, it sounds like everybody is primarily on board with the need for the staffing, and it sounds like there's just a couple of different suggestions on how to deal with it. We heard from Vice Mayor Story suggesting maybe we look at the budget, we look at maybe reorganizing some of the expenditures. Council Member Peterson suggested potentially looking again at that COVID fund, and Mayor Brooks, I know you suggested probably going with the route that we suggested, the fact suggested of using the fund balance. So we'll bring back some more information, and that'll be one of the key discussion points. It sounds like there's general consensus about the $750,000 fund balance target, and there's some good food for thought that Mayor Brooks put on the table for the ECYP funding. Am I missing anything else? There's other questions I didn't touch on. I'm thinking in terms of council direction.
Did I hear you say CIP project?
Oh, yeah. Well, that's definitely the plan for the next meeting. Is you can see it there at the bottom line, is that we're going to be reviewing the CIP for next year at the next meeting, and we'll be bringing back the cost, the funded status, and then looking at what resources we can bring to get those projects done.
Yeah. I just wanted to add to that list. I had asked for kind of a projection on the WARC funding coming out of Measure F in future years.
That's right. I've got that as well.
Okay.
And also there was a request to have the FAC weigh in about maybe the PERS reserve for that debt reduction.
Councilmember Kaiser?
Yeah, thanks. That was just a follow-up on the WARF. I think, so Jamie, you were saying that we would need to get a hold of that $5.5 million or in order to ask for a bid, or you're like, if we could bid, what would mean that we could or couldn't ask for a bid on the WARF?
Sure. So when a public agency goes to bid, basically what it means is we put out a package and we say, contractors, give us a price to do this project. And before you go to bid, you really want to have a very clear fund plan about how you're going to fund that project when you do get the contractor's response. So what I was trying to suggest, and I may not have explained it very clearly, is that before we go to bid, and best case scenario is maybe we're bidding in the fall, we would really want to say, okay, we're targeting a $6 million or $5 million or $7 million project, and here's how we're going to have that by, say, you know, when we think the project is going to need that much money.
Okay.
So that's what I was trying to suggest is that before we go out and say, hey, we got a project, is we know where the money's coming from.
Totally. Okay, thank you.
There are some jurisdictions which have a requirement that you have the money in the bank before you start. And that can be quite an expensive way to go about financing projects. So that's not something I recommend. We just have to have a clear plan that we know we can execute.
Okay. So I'm assuming we don't need a motion at this time. So we're just going to move forward if everyone's been heard. Okay. So that brings us to item 8, which is adjournment. Thank you, council members. Thank you, staff. We will see you on May 20th for our follow-up meeting to review the rest of the budget. So thank you, everyone. Have a great evening. See you all soon.
Goodbye.